द फ्यूचर बिलोंग्स टू दोज हु बिलीव इन द ब्यूटी ऑफ देयर ड्रीम्स। गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू SST सो सिंपल ट्यूटोरियल। इन द प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी रेड अबाउट वेरियस मेजर्स टेकन बाय द फ्रेंच रिवोल्यूशनरीज टू क्रिएट अ सेंस ऑफ कलेक्टिव आइडेंटिटी अमंग पीपल। वी ऑल्सो रेड द एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव चेंजेस दैट वर मेड बाय नेपोलियन and why Napoleon's rule became unpopular among some people. Today, we will start the second subtopic of your textbook, The Making of Nationalism in Europe, and discuss two small topics here. One, the political features of mid-18th century Europe and social composition of mid-18th century Europe. Let us start with the political features of the mid-18th century Europe. If you look at the map of mid-18th century Europe, we will not find nation-states. What we see as Germany or Italy or Switzerland today as independent nations did not exist then. They were divided into kingdoms, duchies and cantons whose rulers had their autonomous territories, their own territories. In Eastern and Central Europe were under autocratic monarchies within the territories of which lived diverse people. They did not see themselves as sharing a collective identity or a common culture. Often, they spoke different languages and belonged to different ethnic groups. Let us try to understand this with the example of Habsburg Empire. The Habsburg Empire that ruled over Austria-Hungary, for example, was a patchwork of many different regions and people. You can see the different patches in different colors. Such a big empire included many regions where people spoke different languages like German, Italian, Magyar, Polish, etc. It included the Alpine region, the Tyrol, Austria and Sudetenland, as well as the Bohemian region, where the aristocracy was predominantly German-speaking. That means in these places which I spoke just now, you will find German-speaking people. The name Alpine actually comes from the mountain Alps. You know, the Alps are a chain of mountains between Central and Mediterranean Europe. It stretches across the countries of France, Italy, Germany, Austria, Slovenia, Switzerland, Liechtenstein, etc. And Bohemia means present-day Czech Republic. The Habsburg Empire also included the provinces of Lombardy and Venetia, where people spoke Italian. In Hungary, half of the population spoke Magyar, while the other spoke a variety of dialects. In Galicia, the aristocracy spoke Polish. Galicia is the region in the East Central Europe. Besides these important groups, there also lived within the boundary of the empire a mass of subject peasant people. For example, Bohemians and Slovaks to the north, Slovenes in Carniola, Croats to the south, and Romans to the east of Transylvania. Transylvania is a historic Eastern European region now in central Romania. The only tie binding diverse groups together was a common allegiance or loyalty to the emperor. Such differences did not easily promote a sense of political unity. To unite these people amongst this immense diversity was a challenging task. To infuse the feelings of nationalism was not easy. Then how did nationalism and the idea of nation-state emerge? Let us first see the social composition of mid-18th century Europe. Here we will find mainly two classes, the aristocracy and the middle class. The aristocracy is a social class that a particular society considers its highest order. In many states, the aristocracy included the upper class of people, aristocrats with hereditary ranks and titles. Aristocratic status can involve feudal or legal privileges. They are usually below only the monarch of a country. The term aristocrat is often used interchangeably with nobility. I will show you the pages of French Revolution class 9 now. Do you recognize this page? You have seen this page last year. What does the second state comprise of? The aristocrats or nobility? The landed aristocracy was a dominant class in the continent. The members of this class were united by a common way of life that cut across regional divisions. That means their way of living or their lifestyles were similar, whether they belonged to this region or the other. What were the features of this class? They owned estates in the countryside and also townhouses. They spoke French for the purpose of diplomacy and in high society. Their families were often connected by ties of marriage. That means they married within themselves. This powerful class, however, was small in number. To the west, the bulk of land was found by tenants and small owners, while in Eastern and Central Europe, the pattern of land holding was characterized by vast estates which were cultivated by serfs. A tenant is a person who lives in or uses the land and pays rent to the owner. So in Western Europe, farming was done mainly by the tenants, whereas in Central and Eastern Europe, it was done by the serfs. I have explained you serf while dealing with feudalism. Industrialization began in England in the second half of 18th century, and in France and parts of German states, it started during the 19th century. Thus, industrial production started, which led to trade and growth of towns. This gave rise to two classes. One, a working class who worked in the industries, and second, the middle class. This middle class comprised of industrialists, traders, businessmen, whose existence was based on production for the market, and also professionals. I will again show you figure 2, class 9 again. See the third state again. Big businessmen, merchants, court officials, lawyers, etc. Even though they belonged to the third state, they had no problems in paying taxes because they had no dearth of money. Problem of paying taxes was with the poor peasants only. Now I shall show you page 6 of the same chapter. A growing middle class envisaged an end to privileges. I hope you are familiar with this page. The 18th century witnessed the emergence of social groups termed as middle class, who earned their wealth through an expanding overseas trade and from the manufacture of goods such as woolen and silk textiles that were either exported or bought by the richer members of the society. In addition to the merchants and manufacturers, the third state also included professionals such as lawyers or administrative officials. All of them were educated, and it was among this educated middle classes the idea of national unity following the abolition of aristocratic privilege gained popularity. This group believed that no group in society should be privileged by birth. Rather, person's social position must depend upon his merit. Thus, the group required to bring the change has appeared in the scene. This group will work in as the agent of nationalism and bring unity among the people. Here we finish the topic of the day. Students, now you should be able to answer these questions. 1. Till mid 18th century, there were no nation states in Europe. Support the statement with examples. Till mid 18th century, there were no nation states in Europe as we know them today. What we know as Germany, Italy or Switzerland today were divided into kingdom, duchies and cantons. Eastern and Central Europe were under autocratic monarchies. within the territories of which lived diverse people. They did not see themselves as sharing a collective identity or a common culture. Often they spoke different languages and belonged to different ethnic groups. The Habsburg Empire that ruled over Austria-Hungary was a patchwork of many different regions and people. That means you should write where we started the lesson. Question number 2. The Habsburg Empire was a patchwork of different regions and people in Europe. You have to explain this, and the way I have shown you the map, you start with the Alpine region, people speaking German, then you show the Italian speaking provinces of Lombardy and Venetia. You can then write about Hungary where people spoke Magyar, and then you can show other regions where people used to speak a number of different dialects, you know, and thus make an answer of your own. Question number 3. Describe the features of landed aristocracy class of European continent. The landed aristocracy was a dominant class on the continent. The member of this class was united by a common way of life that cut across regional divisions. They owned estates in the countryside and also townhouses. They spoke French for the purpose of diplomacy and in high society. Their families were often connected by ties of marriage. This powerful aristocracy class was, however, numerically a small group. 4. How did growth of industrialization change the social and political equation of Europe? In Western and parts of Central Europe, the growth of industrial production and trade meant growth of towns and cities and the emergence of commercial classes whose existence was based on production for the market. Emergence of working class and a new middle class comprising of industrialists, businessmen and professionals. Among the educated liberal middle class, the idea of national unity and abolition of aristocratic privileges gained popularity. Students, today we have discussed the political features of mid-18th century Europe and the social composition of mid-18th century Europe. In the next class, we will see what is liberal nationalism. For any queries, you can use the comment box. Till then, thank you.